Welcome to New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County, New Jersey chapter of the National Organization for Women. My name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I and the entire production crew are members of this chapter of NOW. I don't only mean the people here in the studio, the floor manager, the camera people, but also the people in the control room, the producer, the director, audio and graphics. And for the first time in our 15-year history, our guest, Paula Kassell, is also a member of our chapter of NOW. Our topic today is a very special one, and so is our guest. Our topic takes its name from a new book by Paula Kassell called Taking Women in New Directions, Stories from the Second Wave of the Women's Movement. And if that title sounds familiar to you, that's because its author, a founder of our Morris County chapter of NOW, way back in the early 70s, generously today has, and for the last 15 years, has allowed us, our chapter, to adopt its name as the name of this TV program, New Directions for Women. Paula Kassell is the founder and first editor of the national feminist periodical, New Directions for Women, which began publishing in July of 1972.
Excuse me, January 1972.
Oh, that's even earlier. That's right. It was before Ms. Magazine,
right.
And Ms. was in July. Okay. So we got 6 months ahead.
Right.
And New Directions for Women continued to be published until 1993.
Right.
Is that right?
22 years.
That is really a milestone. And I have known Paula a long time as a friend, as an activist, as a supporter of our NOW chapter. But I must add that until I interviewed you for this program, I had no idea that you're 90 years old.
Oh.
You don't look 90. I was very surprised, and you're still writing.
Well, I must say, every year you work in the women's movement, you get a year younger.
Well, you've done it. You've done it for all these years, and you certainly have gotten younger. This book, this new book, Taking Women in New Directions, is a collection of news articles, editorials, and book reviews from New Directions for Women, published during the 22-year period. It covers the issues that galvanized women to change society completely and forever, as its subtitle reveals.
Yes.
You actually have two subtitles there,
yes.
Right? Yeah, that's great. For those of us who didn't live through this pioneering period, these articles are instructive, they're eye-opening, and they're even shocking. As we know how relatively recently some of these issues were resolved, and mostly after very long struggles. What looks like common sense from today's point of view, you know, you look back, young people look back and say, well, of course you change this and you change that, makes a lot of sense, but it wasn't common sense then. It was a very, very difficult fight for something that a lot of people thought was subversive and even destructive. Destructive of families, destructive of relationships, destructive of the society. And it required courage and hard work to make the changes that we so take for granted today. So you've made history in your lifetime, in our lifetime, at least in my lifetime. And I thank you and welcome you, Paula,
thank
to
you.
Our
I'm so
show.
Glad to be here.
And I'd like to start by asking you a little something about yourself.
Okay.
When you think back, I mean, clearly you were ahead of your time. We call it pioneering time. There must have been, or was there something in either your childhood or your young womanhood that made you aware of differentials in treatment, in expectations, in attitudes based on gender, and that there was an injustice to it? Because I think a lot of people were aware of these differentials, but it didn't feel unjust.
Mm-hmm.
It felt like That's life.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, when I was a freshman in college, this was in 1935, Margaret Mead published a book that changed my life, that opened my eyes, that told me that I could be anything I wanted to be instead of letting society mold me into the way society wanted.
What book was that?
I can't think of the name of the book for the minute, and yet it changed my life. It'll come to me.
I have one of those books too that changed my life, and I often can't remember them. So that's understandable. So was going to a women's college, did that?
Oh yes, that had a great influence on me. Yes.
And yet the fact that you chose a women's college meant that there must have been something even earlier.
No, I don't think so. At that time, my sister went to Barnard before me.
So your parents thought that...
And it was in New York, and I commuted, you know, and I didn't have to live on campus. I could live at home. Yes, the women's college makes a big difference. I'm sorry so many of them have gone.
Have changed,
but
yeah.
But Barnard is still a women's college.
Very, very much alive as a women's college. I'm a Barnard graduate, too.
That's wonderful.
So it's the two of us. So when you came to feminism, that was very early. I mean, it was a time that other people looked on it as suspect. And you became not only involved, but also active in the early organization.
Yes.
What was it that prompted you at that point?
Well, a lot of people don't realize it, but at that point, classified employment ads in the newspapers were divided into help wanted male and help wanted female. They were entirely separate, and of course all the good jobs were under help wanted male, and all the stereotyped low-paying women's jobs were under help wanted female. But one of the things I did at that time, while the ads were still segregated, I actually applied for a job that was listed under help wanted male, and I actually got the job.
Did they say anything to you when you came in for the interview?
Well, the funny thing is that the person who interviewed me was a Barnard graduate.
Really?
And it was a blind ad that didn't tell what company it was. But what it actually turned out to be was Bell Laboratories, and I got the job at Bell Laboratories. It was
radar engineering, I think you told me.
Yes.
Which is really interesting.
Yes, I had to learn radar engineering.
And quite a difference between that and what you ultimately began here.
Right, yes.
Interesting. So, at that time, that was probably the late 60s?
No, when I got that job, it was in the 50s.
No, I meant the time when you started to become active.
It started to change those ads was the late 60s, yes, about 69. That was the first issue I got involved with, was to integrate those ads.
But that was before New Directions for Women was started.
Yes, yes.
How did that get started then?
Well, I had joined now just the year after it was started, but I didn't know a single other feminist in New Jersey in Morris County. I was a lone feminist, and I happened to meet some others finally, and I suggested that we have a statewide conference on feminist issues in order to coordinate our activities. And I did do that. I coordinated a conference at Fairleigh Dickinson in Madison, and we used that's when the title New Directions for Women in New Jersey came up, because it was a New Jersey conference. It happened to be the first statewide conference.
So before that, there were chapters, but there was no...
Yes, around the state there were a few now chapters, and there were a few other little groups in various towns.
Mm-hmm.
And this brought Actually, 300 people came to that conference, which was amazing. And after the conference, when we all get together to talk about it, someone suggested that we should start a newsletter in order to keep everybody together. And
so it's a communications
vehicle. So we could keep communicating and not let these people just go back out on their own without becoming activists. And we had made about $340 on the conference, and we gave $100 of it to National Now because the president came and some of the National Now issue people came and gave workshops. And there was $240 left over, and they gave me this $140 and said, "Here, Paula, start a newsletter."
But the intent of the newsletter was a communication vehicle for the chapters. You weren't imagining a national periodical at that time.
Oh, no, it was a statewide. It was called New Directions for Women in New Jersey. It was intended to be a statewide periodical. Mm-hmm. But after a couple of years, we felt very restricted to be just New Jersey. We dropped In New Jersey from the name and became a national periodical covering national subjects with national distribution.
How did you get the money to, was anybody paid?
No, at that time nobody was paid, neither the writers nor or anybody who put the paper together. Nobody was paid.
But you did charge for subscriptions?
$2.
For a year?
Per year, $2 per year.
And how often did it come out?
Well, at that time it was quarterly.
In the early days?
In the early days, it just came out four times
a
year.
And later, it was?
Later, we became every other month. We never came out monthly, but mm-hmm. but for most of its life, after a while, we came out every other month, but we were bi-monthly.
I have to tell you that I used to read that from cover to cover.
A lot of people tell me they did
it. And it, in many ways, it changed my activism.
Mm-hmm.
One area that you had several articles on was the ways in which United Ways differentiated between the amounts of money that they gave to girls' organizations and boys' organizations, and women's and men's, too.
Right.
So that Girl Scouts got less money than Boy Scouts, and girls' clubs got less money than boys' clubs. And that was the first time that I had never even imagined how United Way distributed its money. I just assumed that they had the best interests of the community at heart. And it was those articles that changed my involvement
yes.
in that. So that was...
We heard from a lot of people about how various issues came up in the paper and it changed their...
A lot.
And that people were amazed when we told them what was going on.
Now, how did you get the skills that you needed?
That's interesting.
Because you said you were in radar engineering.
Everything was learned on the job. We went into this without knowing anything about how to do it. And so, we just did it and learned on the job. But I must say that professional women helped. For instance, there was one woman in a book advertising position. And we didn't know how much to charge for ads. And she said, "Well, if I were going to take an ad in your paper, I would want, say, 2 columns by 6 inches, and I would expect to pay about $60 for that."
Mm-hmm.
And from that one figure, we extrapolated
the whole thing.
The whole thing.
Did you get resistance from people in business to advertising in a feminist periodical?
Well, sure, but we did a lot of book advertising. We did a lot of employment advertising. At that time, there was affirmative act. Later, when the affirmative action came in, a lot of companies were advertising for women employees so they could be doing the affirmative action. So we got employment ads and book ads, and we did a lot of classified advertising. Women were starting to start their own businesses there, at that time and various things, and they like to advertise in our classifieds. So between
classifieds, help wanted male and help wanted female.
The advertising, however much advertising we got for an issue, determined how many pages we were allowed to print, because so we could pay our printer, and the rest of the income came from subscriptions, and we were tax deductible, and we always asked for contributions, and we got a lot of small contributions.
And I do remember your providing multiples of New Directions at conferences and conventions, so that people became aware of it that way.
Yes.
And that's libraries, school libraries too.
Yes, that's we sent a lot of copies to libraries and asked them to put on their lobby shelf with the sign free, and of course, people could pick up a copy of the paper, and there was always a subscription blank in the paper, very mm-hmm. prominent, asking them to subscribe.
And that worked?
Yes, it worked.
It to me, it's amazing that you and this core of other women with no background in journalism were able to produce that paper for so many. This was before Title IX. The regulations for Title IX were not passed until 1975.
Yes.
Well, so you were really charting new territory.
Well, it made a lot of difference to the people who worked on the paper. I remember there was one woman who I gave an assignment to. I said, write an article about such and such. And she said, oh, I can't do that. I don't know how to do that. I said, yes, you do, and yes, you can, and you do it. And she did it. And she said, after that, I could write. It changed my life just because you made me do that.
That's so satisfying. Were there articles that you wrote or that others wrote in New Directions that ultimately had such an impact that you felt it was very satisfying and could be traced to any particular subject?
There's one very, very important article. I want to show you what it looked like, if I can find it here. There was a very important case about paternity leave that a man brought against NBC. It was a dad. What the article looked like. Dad sues NBC in landmark
court case,
and he sued NBC because they were giving maternity leave to women with a proviso that they could come back and get the same job. And they were only giving paternity leave to men, but without the proviso that they could come back. And that's what he sued about.
What was the period of time that they allowed maternity leave and paternity leave?
This article is dated March, April 1982, and the court case hadn't come up yet, but I know that he won the case. He did win the case. So NBC had to give him paternity leave with the proviso that he could come back after, I think it was 6 months. So that was an important one.
And that must have been very satisfying because you had written it up.
Yes.
And I remember that time period because there was another important case in which again, it seemed to be men's rights, but it was really related to gender equity, and that was the case of a man who wanted to get into the University of Mississippi's nursing school and was turned down. And again, he pursued it and he won that case. But it was really women involved in gender equity that brought these benefits to men. There was a Social Security case. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Men could not get the same benefits on account of their wives having worked after their wife died that women could get when they became widowed.
Yes.
And we won that case.
Yes.
Again, it benefited men as well as women.
Another thing that people may not realize was that there were many clubs that would not admit women. As a matter of fact, there was an instance where a woman was actually being the main speaker at a meeting, but they wouldn't let her come in the front door and walk up the main staircase. She had to come in the kitchen, walk up the back stairs. She couldn't even use the elevator. And after she spoke and was applauded for this wonderful speech she made, she had to go back out the kitchen door.
Isn't that amazing? And of course, we know how many deals and networks were resulting from these private clubs.
Yes.
Let's talk about the book, because the newspaper's publishing ended in 93.
Yes.
And now it's about 15 years later.
That's only because I'm such a terrible procrastinator. Could have come out years earlier.
What made you decide to do the book?
Well, I had never published a book before. What made me decide to do the book was that the next generation, this younger generation that we have now.
The book is up on the screen, by the way.
Oh, isn't that nice? The younger generation has no idea of what we went through about these things. I want to read you a little incident that happened that I think is so interesting. At a recent fundraising dinner for a feminist organization called Women for Women International, attended by a friend of mine, the MC was introducing Gloria Steinem. The 20-something young women on both sides of my friend simultaneously turned to her and said, "Who is Gloria Steinem?" She was flabbergasted. I'm flabbergasted too. So I wrote, I put this book together, hoping that it will be assigned in women's studies classes, so the younger generation knows what we went through, realizes how many areas there were of discrimination, and how important it was that we worked and how hard we had to work to get rid of them.
So one of the primary purposes really is to enable young women and men to understand their history.
Right. It's so important not to lose that history.
I wonder if young women and young men really feel that there was any benefit to knowing that history, that their lives would be any different.
Well, they might lose it. They might lose all those things.
All the things we take for granted.
We have to be afraid of what can happen in the Supreme Court in the next few years, because there's a large, large block of people who want to reverse Roe v. Wade for abortion rights, and they don't imagine what it was like when there were no abortion rights.
Mm-hmm. The illegal abortions and loss of life as well. Could you tell us how to order the book?
Oh, sure. Are they going to put it up on the screen there? Yes. How to order.
The book is Taking Women in New Directions.
Yes.
That's the title, and then there are some subtitles.
It's $15.95 each, plus $4 shipping and handling. But if you buy four or more copies, the price goes down to $10.95 per book, plus $4 shipping and handling to each address. And we would prefer you to pay by credit card, and you call the publisher, Hudson House, 845-463-1100 to place an order. Or you can send a check or money order to Hudson House, which is at 675 Duchess Turnpike, Poughkeepsie, New York, 12603. $15.95 plus $4 shipping and handling, or $10.95 plus $4 shipping and handling for four or more.
Excellent.
That's a bargain.
It's a good bargain. It's a very important book, and having been at the university for so many years, I can see it as a very valuable book for our women's studies classes.
And I think people of that age, the 20-somethings or the college age people who take women's studies, will find it very interesting.
I do too. Could I ask you a question? And you're not prepared for this one, I don't think, but maybe you can remember. I looked at the table of contents, which to me is fascinating. And there was one article that I thought I'd love to know what you said in it. It was called Male Pride Equals Too Many Children.
Yes, that applied mostly to African tribes, where the men felt if they didn't impregnate their wife at least once a year, they were not considered real men.
So it was a cultural kind of thing that probably a lot of men who were not African also carry with them.
Yes.
So that was a very interesting one. The one quick question, this is probably a long one, but it's what most of us know you best for, and that is you got the New York Times to change its style of referring to women not by their marital status.
Yes.
Could you?
Yes, that's something I innovated. I bought 10 shares of New York Times stock in order to go to the stockholders meeting. And at that meeting, I brought up various things that I thought the New York Times should or should not be doing. Actually, the first thing I brought up was, did the New York Times pay for dues and services at clubs that did not admit women? And they said yes. In other words, the top executives were going to a club near the Times every day for lunch, and the Times was paying for their lunch, and they were also paying for their dues. And I said,
but the women executives couldn't go there.
Well, there weren't any women executives in those days.
See, that's something we take for granted.
Yeah, now. Right. So the Times, I objected to that, and a few about a week later, I heard from the Sulzberger, the chair of the board, that they had discontinued that. That was the first thing I brought up. But years later, I brought up the idea of using Ms. instead of Ms. And I said to Mr. Sulzberger, when your daughter Karen married, she retained her name. Did she become Mrs. Sulzberger? And he said, I haven't figured that out yet. And I said, well, I challenge you to challenge the editors and writers of the New York Times to debate this issue as whether to use Ms. or not. And a week later, I got a letter from Mr. Sulzberger saying, as of such and such a date, it was 1986. As of such and such a date, the Times will start using Ms. For women who want to be called Ms.
What a triumph.
But there were still some women who wanted to be called Miss or Mrs. Beverly Sills, for instance, wanted to be called Miss Sills.
We have to finish up now,
really?
But thank you so much. This was a fascinating, fascinating talk.
Well, the time went by so fast.
It did. But now you might want to, just for the people here, continue with that story. That it's so amazing that on second reference we had to be called by based on our marital status.
Yes.
And sometimes we weren't even married anymore.